And I welcome Professor Ravi Koreshetter, the speaker for today, and Professor Bahulkar on the dais. And I also invite Mrs. Varsha Gajendra Gadkar on the dais. भंडारकर प्राच्यविद्या संशोधन मंदिराच्या वतीने साधारणपणे 15 व्याख्यानमाला या वर्षभरामध्ये चालवले जातात आणि त्या व्याख्यानमालांपैकी एक ही कडंबी मीनाक्षी सी मीनाक्षी स्मृती व्याख्यानमाला आणि ती एकच व्याख्यानमाला आमच्याकडची अशी आहे की जी पुरातत्वाशी संबंधित आहे. या वेळेला ही व्याख्यानमाला दोन संस्थांच्या माध्यमातून एकत्रितपणे घ्यावी अशा प्रकारची कल्पना ही मांडली गेली डॉक्टर राचीम ढेरे यांच्या स्मृतिप्रीत्यर्थ जे सांस्कृतिक अध्ययन केंद्र स्थापन झालेलं आहे ते आणि भंडारकर इन्स्टिट्यूट अशी ती एकत्र व्याख्यानमाला घ्यावी अशी सूचना आली होती आणि ती अर्थातच स्वागतार्ह सूचना होती. त्यामुळे ही व्याख्यानमाला अशा पद्धतीने आपण आयोजित करतोय. मी आपणा सगळ्यांचं स्वागत करतो आणि संस्थेचे मानद सचिव डॉक्टर श्रीकांत बहुलकर यांना अशी विनंती करतो की त्यांनी कृपया या कार्यक्रमाचं प्रास्ताविकाचं हे करावं. ते करतो
friends, it's a matter of great pleasure for all of us can you hear me yeah to welcome our good old friend Professor Ravi Koreshetter, who spent several years of his active life in the Department of Archaeology of the Deccan College. We have invited him to deliver a lecture as a Sea Meenakshi Memorial Lecture. This is the 5th memorial lecture. On this occasion, I would like to speak a few words about Sea Meenakshi, in whose loving memory this lecture is being arranged every year. Dr. Miss C. Meenakshi was assistant professor of history in Maharani's College, Mysore University. She got a very short lifespan, during which she did monumental work. Unfortunately, she passed away at the early age of 33 on 3rd March 1940. Born in a Tamil Brahmin family of Kanjivaram, early in her age, she took to study on Western lines, a course which, for a lady in those days, the orthodox Brahmanism of her time did not view with favor, but which paved the way for her distinction. After completing her undergraduate studies in the Women's Christian College, Madras, she prosecuted her postgraduate study in history at the Madras Christian College, from which she was the first lady to take the MA degree, which she took with distinction. In recognition of her merit, the University of Madras granted her a scholarship for advanced research in Indian history in 1931 for 2 years, which was extended for an additional term of a year in consideration of the importance and value of her researches. She selected as her subject for investigation the administration and social life under the Pallavas, including Pallava art and the valuable work done by her in advancing the knowledge in the subject, earned for her the PhD degree, a distinction she was the first lady to receive from the University of Madras. A large part of the results of her investigations was published by the university in the form of a book entitled Administration and Social Life Under the Pallavas, a work which has been well received by the world of scholars and the lay public alike as bearing a high mark of perfection and scholarship. The Madras University gave her further opportunity to conduct research in other important aspects of ancient South Indian history by granting her a fellowship in 1937 for a year, an opportunity which she made excellent use of in investigating into the history of Buddhism in South India. The archaeological tours she conducted in connection with her new work and the discoveries she made attracted the attention of the Archaeological Department of India, who, recognizing her capacity and erudition, entrusted to her the task of preparing archaeological memoirs on the historical sculptures in the Vaikuntha Perumal Temple and the Kailashnath Temple, Kanchi. It is with extreme regret that we have to note that before the results of her varied researches could be published, she was snatched away from this world. It is sad to contemplate the qualities of a person who is no more. In the death of Dr. Meenakshi, who was known to be a musician of a high order, a scholar at once brilliant, painstaking, and conscious, and a lively personality characterized by gentle and straightforward behavior, South India has lost a distinguished and a valuable Samha whose life was full of promise. With these words, I conclude my short speech and welcome today's speaker, Professor Connie Sanchkar. I also welcome Varsha Gajendra Gadkar and Dr. Aruna Dhere and other trustees, Milinda Dhere and Varsha Shraddha Kulkarni, the office bearers of the Trust of R.C. Dhere Cultural Research Center, and I request Professor Kori Sekhar to begin his lecture. I request Varsha Gajendra Gadkar to speak a few words about the purpose of the research center that is newly established and the activities they have conducted and proposed to conduct.
नमस्कार. मी मराठीत बोलतीये. एकतर तुम्ही सगळे श्रोते मराठी जाणणारे आहात आणि दुसरी गोष्ट म्हणजे आजचं व्याख्यान जरी इंग्रजीमध्ये असलं तरी डॉक्टर कोरी सेट्टर अनेक वर्ष पुण्यात होते आणि त्यामुळे त्यांना मराठी चांगलं समजतं. डॉक्टर राचीम ढेरे संस्कृती संशोधन केंद्राच्या वतीने मी सगळ्यांचं पुन्हा एकदा स्वागत करते आणि आजच्या या कार्यक्रमाला भांडारकर संस्थेचा जो सहयोग मिळाला आहे त्यासाठी मनापासून झालेला आनंदही सुरुवातीलाच व्यक्त करते. अण्णांचा या संस्थेशी अनेक वर्षांचा आणि फार निकटचा संबंध होता आणि हा संबंध फक्त संदर्भ मिळवण्यापुरता नव्हता, एका मोठ्या ज्ञानपरंपरेशी बांधलेलो आहोत आपण, ज्ञानपरंपरेचा एक भाग आहोत असं समजून अण्णा या संस्थेशी जोडलेले राहिले. आणि इथल्या आणि बाहेरून इथे येणाऱ्या अनेक अभ्यासकांचा अभ्यास आणि संशोधनाच्या पलीकडे विस्तारणारा स्नेहही अण्णांना मिळाला ही अण्णांसाठी आणि आम्हा सगळ्यांसाठीही भाग्याची गोष्ट होती. आज हे मुद्दाम सांगावंसं वाटतंय. डॉक्टर राजीव ढेरे संस्कृती संशोधन केंद्राची स्थापना गेल्या वर्षी एप्रिलमध्ये अण्णा असतानाच झाली, ती अण्णांचं काम पुढे नेण्याच्या उद्देशाने. अण्णांच्या मोठ्या ग्रंथसंग्रहाचं जतन करणं, अण्णांनी लिहिलेल्या पुस्तकांचं इंग्रजी अनुवाद करून घेणं, अण्णांच्या अभ्यास क्षेत्राशी संबंधित संशोधन प्रकल्प हातात घेणं आणि अण्णांची जी संशोधन दृष्टी होती ती पुढच्या पिढीतल्या अभ्यासकांपर्यंत पोचवण्यासाठी चर्चासत्र, व्याख्यानं, कार्यशाळा आणि शिबिरांचं आयोजन करणं असे हेतू मनात ठेवून केंद्राची स्थापना झाली आहे. आजचं व्याख्यान हा त्याचाच एक भाग आहे. डॉक्टर कोरीसेट्टर आणि अण्णा यांच्या भेटी कमी वेळेला झाल्या आहेत, पण अण्णांच्या कामाविषयी त्यांना आस्था आणि आदर आहे. आणि संपूर्ण दक्षिण भारत आणि महाराष्ट्र यांच्यातल्या सांस्कृतिक दुव्यांवर प्रकाश टाकणारं जे लेखन अण्णांनी केलं आहे, त्या 8-10 पुस्तकांचा कानडीमध्ये अनुवाद कर्नाटक विद्यापीठाने करून घेतला आहे आणि मला वाटतं या दोघांमधला तोही एक मोठा दुवा आहे. गेल्या वर्षी ऑगस्टमध्ये आम्ही धारवाडला विद्यापीठात गेलो, त्यावेळेला सरांची भेट झाली. आणि अलीकडच्या काळामध्ये फक्त भारतातच नाही तर सगळ्याच दक्षिण आशियाई देशांमध्ये प्रागैतिहासिक काळातल्या लज्जागौरीच्या ज्या मूर्ती सापडल्या त्याविषयीचं संशोधन मांडणारा एक पेपर त्यांनी लिहिला आहे असं आम्हाला कळलं. आणि तेव्हाच अण्णांचं काम पुढे नेणाऱ्या या अभ्यासकाला केंद्राच्या वतीने एकदा व्याख्यानासाठी निमंत्रित करावं असं आमच्या मनात आलं. इतिहास आणि पुरातत्व या दोन्ही विषयातल्या देशातल्या अनेक संस्थांशी खरं तर डॉक्टर कोरीसेट्टर निगडीत आहेत आणि त्यामुळे अतिशय व्यग्र आहेत, पण आमची विनंती त्यांनी अतिशय साधेपणाने मान्य केली आणि त्यामुळेच आजचा हा कार्यक्रम होतो आहे. मी त्यांचे आभारही मानते आणि त्यांचा परिचय थोडक्यात करून देते. डॉक्टर कोरीसेट्टर सध्या भोपाळमधल्या डॉक्टर व्ही एस वाकणकर आर्कॉलॉजिकल रिसर्च इन्स्टिट्यूटचे सिनियर फेलो आहेत. त्याआधी ते डॉक्टर डी सी पावटे चेअर फॉर आर्ट अँड आर्कॉलॉजी या कर्नाटक विद्यापीठातल्या अध्यासनाचे चेअर प्रोफेसर होते. 2013 ते कर्नाटक विद्यापीठाच्या इतिहास आणि पुरातत्व विभागातून प्रोफेसर म्हणून निवृत्त झाले. मगाशी मी म्हणलं तसा डॉक्टर कोरीसेट्टरांचा पुण्याशी फार जवळचा संबंध आहे, कारण पुण्यात डेक्कन कॉलेजमध्ये त्यांचं पदव्युत्तर शिक्षणही झालं आहे आणि PhDही त्यांनी तिथेच केली आहे. 1989 ते धारवाडच्या कर्नाटक विद्यापीठात इतिहास आणि पुरातत्व विभागात रुजू झाले आणि त्यानंतर त्यांनी भारतातल्या आणि भारताबाहेरच्या काही संस्थांच्या सहयोगाने अनेक संशोधन प्रकल्प ओळींनी हातात घेतले आणि ते पूर्णही केले. अश्मयुगीन संस्कृतींविषयीचं मुख्यतः संशोधन त्यांनी खूप मोठ्या प्रमाणात केलं आहे. कर्नाटकातल्या संगनाकल्लू इथल्या उत्खननात त्यांचा पुढाकार होता. दक्षिण भारतातल्या कृषी अर्थव्यवस्थांचा उगम शोधण्यासाठी हे उत्खनन मुख्यतः झालं होतं. रॉक आर्ट, खडकांवरची चित्रं हाही त्यांच्या संशोधनाचा विषय आहे. आणि सध्यासुद्धा ते विंध्य आणि कडाप्पा या दोन खोऱ्यातल्या प्रागैतिहासिक काळातल्या याच कलेचा तौलनिक अभ्यास करतायत. त्यांचे शोधनिबंध आणि संपादित पुस्तकं देशात आणि परदेशातही प्रसिद्ध झाली आहेत. द राईज ऑफ अर्ली ह्युमन बिहेवियर इन ग्लोबल कंटेक्स्ट, इंडियन आर्कॉलॉजी इन रिट्रोस्पेक्ट, क्वॅटर्नरी एन्व्हायरमेंट्स अँड जिओ आर्कॉलॉजी ऑफ इंडिया ही त्यांनी संपादित केलेली काही महत्त्वाची पुस्तकं आहेत. सध्या नो मोर स्टोन अँड स्टोन ओवर्स या द्विखंडात्मक ग्रंथाचं संपादन ते करत आहेत. उपयोजित आपल्या संशोधनाला उपयोजिततेची दिलेली जोड हे डॉक्टर कोरीसेट्टर यांच्या कामाचं ठळक वैशिष्ट्य आहे आणि खरं तर आर्कॉलॉजीच्या क्षेत्राला त्यांचं हे मोठं योगदानही आहे. देशाच्या सांस्कृतिक ऐतिहासिक वारशाचा ऱ्हास रोखण्यासाठी एक धोरण म्हणून पब्लिक आउटरीच आर्कॉलॉजीचं उपयोजन त्यांनी केलेलं आहे. आर्कॉलॉजिकल साईट्सच्या परिसरात राहणाऱ्या स्थानिक रहिवाशांमध्ये आपल्या वारशाविषयीची आपल्या परंपरेविषयीची जाणीव निर्माण करणाऱ्या उपक्रमांसाठी त्यांनी पुढाकार घेतला आहे. आजच्या व्याख्यानात आपण याच संदर्भातली दक्षिण भारतातली यशोगाथा ऐकणार आहोत. मी त्यांना डायसवर येण्यासाठी निमंत्रित करते. सर,
good evening everybody. I may be permitted to speak in English. I may understand Marathi, but I may not be able to express myself, so I have your permission to speak in English. Dr. Srikant Bahulkar, Varshathai Gajendkarkar, members of the respected Dere family, Runa Dere and Milind Dere, my teacher Professor Rajguru, and the August assembly of senior scholars and friends. Before I embark on my presentation, I would like to express my personal feelings in a few sentences. I stand before you with a deep sense of humility in this hallowed institution that is celebrating a century of yeoman service in disseminating Indological knowledge to the society at large. I am humbled by this honor to deliver the 5th C. Meenakshi Memorial Lecture. I find it difficult to express my appreciation of the efforts of the respected Dere family and their persistent persuasion and their inexhaustible patience has eventually brought me here. Well, Deccan College, my alma mater, is the premier center of archaeology in India. The Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute is a colossus among Indological institutions in India. Both these institutions have provided me with stimulus and inspiration. When Srimati Varshathai Dhere invited me to deliver lecture under the joint auspices of the BORI and Dr. R.C. Dhere Center for Cultural Studies, I was wondering if I will be able to fit into the framework of academic activities of the BORI. However, they encouraged me to present a lecture on a topic of my choice. I agreed, and so I stand before you to share my experience of public outreach archaeology. For me, coming to Pune is like coming home, and I'm happy and excited about it. The topic of my today's presentation is heritage resources and public outreach initiatives, the success story of preserving heritage of southern India. The word heritage and resources have different meanings for different people who are engaged in archaeological research and dissemination and so on. Heritage, heritage conservation, heritage preservation is a very popular among conservation archaeologists. But heritage as such has several meanings, and there are categories of heritage. There are tangible heritage, intangible heritage, and cultural heritage, and also invisible heritage. While conservation and preservation is the chief concern of the conservation architects, heritage, which is the mainstream of archaeological research of any given time period, is the focus of all branches of the discipline of archaeology. So in this context, my emphasis is more on invisible heritage, which is otherwise prehistoric heritage, which is not easily visible. Whereas historical heritage, focusing only on monuments, is concerned about restoration and preservation. But prehistoric heritage, extends over large areas in terms of landscapes, which are not easily recognizable by common man. And it does not also attract the eyes of even the people who are living in the neighborhood of landscapes, cultural landscapes. So it is now necessary for us to make sure that people are made aware of this kind of invisible heritage that has a lot of information in store, which can be profitably exploited by modern methods of research, and that can help us in unraveling the past as completely as possible. Resources, when we think in terms of resources, heritage is a commodity for tourism development. Heritage is a source of information for reconstructing the past. So our focus should be both. It will be a multi-pronged approach to treat heritage from the perspective of reconstructing the life phase of the past, human societies, as well as utilize these resources effectively and more productively to be able to develop tourism strategies that can also earn, you know, revenues for further development of both heritage, its preservation, and so on and so forth, as well as its availability for study across a wider section of archaeologists and laymen together. In this context, it became essential for us because I'm primarily a prehistorian, and I was encountering series of problems when we were working at some of these early prehistoric sites. So it became essential for us to get ourselves, you know, in an interactive mode with the people who own this particular kind of heritage. If that is not possible, we live in isolation and we have no idea of what these villagers or the people who live in the neighborhood of these early prehistoric settlements think about them. And their importance is made known to them, it is even more productive for archaeologists who work at such sites. Next, please. So this particular sentence, archaeology needs the public as it is all about them. The more people are involved, the better archaeology becomes for everyone. This is a very compelling sentence and makes archaeologists aware of their responsibilities, which is neglected so far, because archaeologists work for archaeologists. So it is no more a situation where archaeologists continue to work for archaeologists, and it is very, very clear that archaeology is by the people, for the people, and of the people. If we want to realize the real meaning of this particular sentence, we'll have to embark ourselves and open up new dimensions in archaeological research, and that is one aspect of archaeological research which is field-oriented, is public outreach archaeology. We organized three field seasons of public outreach archaeology in southern India, and this outreach session was in direct communication with villagers, townspeople, administrators, and archaeologists in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, particularly at some sites like Jolapuram, which is one of the oldest Paleolithic sites we have in India, and Kottala is another place where we have a natural limestone cave, which was known to archaeologists and geologists for more than a century. And that is both a natural heritage as well as an archaeological heritage for us. And such of these natural heritage sites are also subject to vandalism, destruction, you know, mining activity because of development and all that. And then we have the villages like Patapadu, Sanganakalu. These are the sites which are also known to us for a very, very long time, from the time of 1880s, as you know, early Neolithic sites, the time when human societies settled down and became agriculturists. And some of these sites are also huge landscapes which have not been known to many people, particularly those people who live in the neighborhood of these archaeological sites. And Bellary is a district headquarters wherein we had to communicate with the district authorities to make them aware of the fact that there are some of these sites which are being destroyed beyond, you know, any control, and if destruction continues, the sites will also be erased from the ground. If this happens, we will be losing the vital heritage which has in store, you know, a lot of information about our past. So in this context, it's not the government agencies like Archaeological Survey of India or the State Department of Archaeology in the state level, but also the district level administration has direct control on some of these sites. Not all the archaeological sites, be it of prehistoric period or historical period, are protected or preserved or conserved. So there are some sites which have not been under this particular category of preservation and conservation. But then these sites are, you know, great repositories of our past. So some of them which have been subject to archaeological investigations requires to be preserved, because each of these sites cannot be exhausted in terms of extracting information about our past in one or two seasons or in the lifetime of an archaeologist. There are some sites in southern India where even 100 archaeologists working together for 100 years will not be able to exhaust the amount of information that is stored in archaeological sites. So we thought, in order to make sure that some representative sites which have in store valuable information about our past, we have realized them in recent past, needs to be preserved for posterity. And that is where the only strategy that could be adopted was public outreach archaeology models that are again imported from outside, and application of these models were very, very useful. And why we have to, you know, undertake public outreach archaeology? First and foremost, as I said, majority of sites are threatened. Next one. Majority of the sites are threatened by development and ignorance of the diversity of heritage and its value as source of the past, typical of the life ways in the third world, because we have little awareness of the fact that archaeological sites are important for us, important parcel of both present and past as well as future. In this situation, many of these archaeological records are getting erased from the ground. It was recognized that public outreach project could provide interesting and useful information that contributes to our understanding of the history of the region and symbolic aspects of the landscape material culture. Because in prehistoric context, the material culture is part and parcel of the landscape. It is not easily visible. It is not. It does not stand above the ground. So it is mixed up with the upper surface of the earth. And that is where it is now essential for us to make sure that such landscapes are not simply ignored and left for, you know, destruction. And ultimately, if such programs are organized, will lead to systematic documentation. Now, you know, we have very modern methods of documentation. We have digital methods which can, you know, preserve the site in a digital form for any number of years and for future study as well. Otherwise, you know, routine mapping of the sites will not provide so much information in comparison with the modern methods like total station survey mapping, which can be done with very at close contour intervals and place each and every cultural material into that particular map. And that is available for study at any time. And the computer virtual you know, images that we can develop from the material we have collected can also be, you know, made available to people who would like to undertake research on that. And so, next one. Who owns the past in that case? Among many possible heritage tourism development models, the one involving the largest amount of resident populations. This is where we have to be giving more emphasis. We normally ignore the local population and we work in isolation. And local population has its own ideas about their village historicity and so on and so forth. And if we work in isolation, we are just visitors to that village and we don't intermingle with the local community which owns that particular heritage. And if it is possible for us to make them aware of what is there in the neighborhood of that, you know, that community, it will also benefit us. It'll go through this particular aspect gradually. And this involving them also helps them in their well-being, because if you develop a tourism strategy at any given archaeological site and involve the local population, their skills and crafts, craftsmen in the area can be involved in the tourism proposal, and that helps them find opportunities of employment, self-earning, and so on and so forth. And many such landscapes have been inscribed by the, you know, in India, we have several Paleolithic or early Stone Age landscapes, which are not known to many of us, have already been inscribed as World Heritage Sites, cultural landscapes. Fortunately, I was involved in identifying some landscapes within India, northern Karnataka and in central India, Vindhyan region, and proposed the identification of these landscapes as World Heritage Sites. They cannot be completely preserved, but at least the evidence that is there can be documented systematically for posterity. Public outreach archaeology has become an essential and important aspect of all archaeological projects. So until now, archaeological projects were not aiming at this particular aspect of their responsibility. It is now becoming a desideratum. And you have to have a separate component in your archaeological team which will focus their attention on this particular aspect of public outreach archaeology. An excavator himself will not be able to spend time with the villagers and the people who are concerned with the archaeological site and so on. So he has to have a group or a team expertise with an expertise in public outreach methods, and they should be interacting with the excavators and then interact with the local people and so on. The benefits are already there. This was intensified in the context of the sites I mentioned. This program was intensified as a significant and valuable component of projects at Sanganakallur in Javalapuram to be able to test its prospects as well as consequences. So how frequent are they in India? This is a simple question we have to ask ourselves and make ourselves responsible for not having such programs as part and parcel of archaeological excavation projects. Next one. So here I'm focusing on southern India, especially northern part of Karnataka and the southwestern part of Andhra Pradesh. In these regions, we have those sites which I mentioned in the beginning. So the districts of the northeastern districts from Bidar, Gulbarga to Bellary, and further eastwards into Andhra Pradesh, we have these large landscapes. We have the oldest settlements ranging in time from 1.2 million years to recent past as well. Next one. So this is one of the landscape prehistoric landscapes which has been proposed to be recognized or inscribed as a World Heritage landscape, prehistoric landscape, or what we call Paleolithic landscape. This is an area of about 500 square kilometers in northern part of Karnataka in the district of Yadgir, where Deccan College Professor Padaya worked for three decades, and he has been successful in identifying a large number of sites scattered over this area. Some of the dots, triangles and all, are the indications of the scatter of sites in a small area of 500 square kilometers. And here is one of the sites known as Isampur. On the right-hand side, we have those two slides, where he excavated the oldest stone quarry of the lower Paleolithic period. And this particular place, he was able to assemble pieces of stones which were products of stone axe manufacturing activity and put them together into a block. So that is what we call refitting. And then the way in which the processing sequence, procurement of raw material, processing raw material, and then finishing the raw material into desired stone artifact, whether it is a hand axe, cleaver, and so on. And that is why this was called the quarry site, where exactly the stones, hand axes and cleavers of the lower Paleolithic were manufactured. And there is a dense scatter of these artifacts. And then along with that, he also found some fossils of animals which were dated by a technique called ESR dating method. And we have a date for this site 1.2 million years ago, almost 12 lakh years ago. And for the first time, we have clear evidence of the fact that humans who migrated out of Africa came into the subcontinent as early as Lower Pleistocene. There is one more site supporting this particular date further south in Tamil Nadu, which is known as Athirappakkam. That is dated to about 15 lakh years ago. So such landscapes have got to be preserved, because we are not very sure what else is there in this particular site, what more future research can contribute to our understanding of the life phase of the people, activities performed at this particular spot, and so on. Now, if you go back into this area, because of ongoing development in terms of canals running into this area, the original barren landscape has now been transformed into wet agricultural land. There is no trace of this site if you go back. And it's become so difficult to relocate this site. So such is monumental loss to archaeologists who would be interested. At least this particular site among several hundred sites known from this area should have been preserved, made an attempt to preserve or some such thing. So that is one example where we have lost prehistoric heritage to developmental activity. Next one. Now this is another natural landscape, limestone caves in the Kurnool district of Andhra Pradesh. We have the cave known as Billasargam near the town of Kanumak in the Kottala. And the site was excavated way back in 1880s by Robert Brucefoot and his son, because at that time the concern was to understand human evolution from the perspective of Charles Darwin. And Foote was requested to go and excavate here because caves were considered the ideal places where human remains are likely to be well preserved if they were there. So site was excavated in the 80s. So far we have not been able to strike human fossils in this area. This is a thick deposit of animal fossils, and recent past we have rock art and so on and so forth. This site is also being subject to quarrying, because limestone blocks are detached in order to generate variety of slabs which are used for construction purposes and so on. Here it became most essential for us to interact with local villagers and make sure this is arrested. And in addition to, you know, involving the local population, we also went to the local sarpanch and the leaders, you know, who are major mining barons in this area, request them at least this site should not be subject to further quarrying and so on. We have been successful to some extent. Next one. This is the interior part of the cave. We have varieties of these features, geological features like stalactites and so on, and other features on the floor right there. You have a couple of trenches which were dug. Next one. And there we have a large number of animal bones going back to nearly 200,000 years. For the last 2 lakh years time period, we have history of animal population, wild animals living in this area. And also we have found evidence of volcanic ash in these deposits, which is dated to about 74,000 years ago. Until now, we did not have any idea of the chronology of the cave deposits in this region. On the right-hand side, we have a diamond-shaped concentric engravings, and this has been dated by radiocarbon method to 4,500 years ago, roughly to the Neolithic period in that region. So if these caves are subject to, you know, this kind of developmental activity or so-called vandalism, we are likely to lose this evidence forever. Next one. And then southeast of this particular cave, we have this particular site called Jolapuram, where we found in the buried context the presence of Middle Paleolithic remains, stone artifacts, which were produced by our immediate ancestors. We call them Homo sapiens, our immediate ancestors who emerged in Africa around 200,000 years ago, gradually migrated out of Africa and entered the Indian subcontinent. So we were not sure when this particular event happened in the past. Here we have a deposit, a whitish deposit that we see there is the volcanic ash. The glass shards of this particular volcanic ash were found in the previous cave. And here is a thick deposit, and this deposit is dated to 74. Further down below, at least 1.5 meters further down below this particular ash, we have the distinctive Middle Paleolithic horizon containing this kind of artifacts. And for the first time, we have a date, a perfect date, absolute date for the situation here. Ash is 74,000 years old, and below that we have two OSL dates, optically stimulated luminescence dating method was applied to the sediment underlying the ash and overlying the Paleolithic horizon, and that dates back to about 77,000 to 80,000 years ago. So first time in India, we had some relative dates for the Middle Paleolithic. We have absolute dates for the Middle Paleolithic at least 80,000 years. We have some clues from other areas like in Rajasthan and elsewhere, but this one is most, you know, well-documented site during the course of the research that we carried out in that part of the subcontinent. Next. We move towards another region, which is granitic region, where we have the earliest villages, where the community was engaging themselves in food production. The beginning of village life, agricultural way of life, domestication of plants and animals and so on. Some of these sites were located on tops of granitic hills. Now some of these hills are also subject to that kind of vandalism in the name of development, in the name of building highways and golden quadrangular, and so the material required for laying the road metal was procured from some of these without knowing the fact that this is a national monument, this is a cultural monument, this is a landscape which cannot be subject to this kind of mining activity, because the contractors and the district authorities who give them permission, they have no knowledge of what it is. But this is one of the sites which is known to archaeologists for more than 150 years. The same Dr. Robert Brucefoot, who excavated limestone cave in Kurnool area, was the first person to make systematic study and documentation of what is in there. Here we have rock paintings, we have evidence of grinding hollows where grains were processed, stone artifacts were polished. We have house floors with post holes and so on. We have burials in the form of megaliths and so on. Next. And then we have large areas on top of the hill where stone axes were manufactured in millions, in terms of millions. Can imagine the extent of activity that was going there. This is the excavated area where we found waste products, resulting from stone axe manufacturing activity associated with the Neolithic time period. And then we have ash mounds representing deliberately accumulated ash, cow dung, and then set on fire. on various occasions. They were episodically burnt, and this is the site where Professor Rajguru also worked in the 1960s, and we have gone there in the recent past. And then when we looked at this state of affairs, we thought, yes, we cannot simply sit and cry, but we have to make some effort to save the site from further destruction. Next. So this is the example of stone axes, polished stone axes, unlike the stone axes from the site of Isampur, which are much older. These are, in time, they are about 4,500 to 800 years ago. And then we have these hollows where the stone axe was polished or ground, and then the edges were ground in those grooves and so on. Such features are part of the landscape. So they are not, you know, standing above the ground. They are not known to the people. They simply see, you know, villagers have no idea of what these marks are and so on. And only we have an idea of what they are and what they mean to us. So our immediate responsibility was not to publish whatever our findings in professional, you know, highly, you know, restricted audience, but to make immediate impact should be on the villagers who live in the area and who own them. The landscapes, the fields, agricultural fields belong to them, and they are not aware of their importance. Next. And then when you go further in the same area, we have a series of cluster of early historic, the first writings that southern India witnessed was during the time of Ashoka. He was the one who got the first ever written records, you know, inscribed on the boulders of granitic rocks. And these Ashokan edicts are also there. They are lying isolated in various fields, and nobody is aware of them. And one of them, a couple of those Ashokan edicts were discovered when geologists went to give permit for local people to quarry the granite. So if the geologist had no knowledge of this particular writing on the boulder, and if he had not brought it to the notice of concerned people, that Ashokan edict, which also carries the name of Ashoka, would have been lost forever. So these are some of the concerns that we have as archaeologists about, you know, not being able to preserve the evidence, which is very, very vital for a thorough understanding of our past. Next. And then we come towards later period. I just give you the example of World Heritage Site of Hampi. This is one of the World Heritage Sites in that area. In addition, we have Pattadakal, which is known for early structural temples in this area. But then there are so many such landscapes, and this is not one single monument or a cluster of temples. It is the entire landscape going over an area of 2,500 square kilometers. And it is all wetland agriculture, and lot of these features have been lost. But then, once this status of a World Heritage Site has been accorded, people have been making efforts to make sure that whatever has been lost is restored, and then whatever has been not, you know, brought to the surface is being brought to the surface systematically. This is how it happens. But who is responsible for all this if it is lost, you know, from our, you know, purview of study? So the variety of tangible, intangible heritage that we have in medieval period. As you go backwards in time, we have both tangible, intangible heritage, maybe in smaller, you know, density, but then they are equally important. Next. So the way in which the Sanganakallu site is subject to vandalism, the site of Jolapuram, which I mentioned earlier, is also subject to large-scale mining. This whitish material, which I mentioned as volcanic ash, is also being mined for detergent industry. People who are mining this material are not at all aware of what it is. They just call it whitish powder, and it is useful for making detergent soaps. Nothing else they are aware. But until we went there in the early part of the 21st century, nobody knew that it was volcanic ash. So what we can do about it? We cannot certainly stop developmental activity, but at least systematic documentation, so that it can, the document will help us understand the site in various dimensions, even without being able to go and have access to real, you know, depositions there. Next. So this is the close-up view of the way in which the hilltop village settlement was subject to destruction. This was taken in 1997. But then we had to launch a campaign, and this campaign would not have been successful if the authorities and the local villagers did not understand what we were trying to, you know, convince them. And so, next one, another, strike, yeah. So this entire group of cluster of hills is covering over 1,000 acre of land, and each and every millimeter of this land has cultural material belonging to the time period from 3000 BC to 800 BC. Nearly 2200 years of history of human settlement. This is one site which also gives us a clear idea of transition from, you know, agricultural, late agricultural way to early urbanization. Urbanization, otherwise we think it started with the Shatavahana period in southern India. But we have documented evidence which gives us an indication that surplus production involving large scale trading activity over long distances was because of the site was the largest stone axe manufacturing center. And as I mentioned, millions of these stone axes were manufactured and traded across a network of settlements in that region. So such sites, you know, as I mentioned, 100 archaeologists working together for 100 more years will not be able to exhaust archaeology of this particular site. So this is a situation which demands, it warrants, you know, concerted efforts to make sure that if not all the 300 sites in one area, at least 30 sites, if they can be, you know, preserved. And if each one of us, during the course of our career as archaeologists, adopt one such site and see what can be done to make sure that the site is not subject to destruction, is our responsibility. Next. So the only way we could do in this direction was undertake outreach and inreach. Outreach relates to interacting with people outside the sphere of archaeologists. Inreach relates to interaction within and among ourselves who are working together on an archaeological site. So public outreach involvement is participation helps to understand how do rural communities in southern India think about their past. How do they produce and preserve their knowledge? And what do they think about archaeology and archaeologists? They have weird ideas about all these things. Unless we sit with them and then convince them what is this and what is that, and they come to senses and they help us a lot, and it was much more productive. The key to the success of outreach projects is creative, innovative, and imaginative public input. People have different ideas about their past, their village history, their village, you know, antiquity, and so on and so forth. You know, if they see a megalithic burial monument, they attribute that to Pandavas, they attribute that to Mauryas, and so on. It's very unscientific, it's very imaginative. And they also have the sense of great antiquity of their sites. And particularly at Sanganakallu, we found that each and every feature, a scratch on the boulder was suspected as an indescript. How can we convince them? So unless we make them aware of the intricacies of understanding the archaeological phenomena at a given site, they will not understand anything. But then they have to be held responsible for its preservation. And their participation in decision making, particularly how to go about working at this particular site. Most of the archaeologists are always misunderstood as people who come, you know, in search of buried treasure and so on. That is a strong mindset among the villagers. So we have to make sure that this is removed from their mind. A major attempt is to capture the input meanings and perspectives on all aspects, all projects from all interested individuals and groups in the village, and village is a very complex society. We have taken these public outreach elements and concepts and applied them to, next one, to our archaeological projects in southern India. Our model for this particular approach was the model generated by Delaware Department of Transportation in USA. And an expert by name Kevin Cunningham has been a cultural resource management specialist working in the Delaware region of USA, and he offered to help us. And the model they had generated for southeastern United States was applicable to the situations here, because it's a model which is scientific, is applicable to any part of the world at any given point of time. So this model was very helpful, and in fact, in addition to providing us academic inputs, there were also resources made available. First and foremost thing that he advised us to do was, whenever we go and camp at an archaeological site, you carry exotic gifts. Gifts play a very, very important role in you being welcomed by the village community. Go to the schools and meet the children, give them these gifts and attract them, and their parents will naturally come to you to find out what is happening with us. And we can interact with them and find out, you know, what will be their response if we want to, you know, organize an excavation program here, not for 1 or 2 days, lasting over several seasons and so on. So outreach and inreach archaeology. Inreach, as I mentioned, you see, all of us who are engaged in field work, we have our own responsibilities. We generate our own data by the end of the day. So we have to come back and sit and together and share our experience of the day amongst ourselves and generate a new model for communication with the villagers. And while you are doing this in-reach activity, also get these villagers, you know, observe what you are discussing. And language is not a barrier at all. You may have interpreters, you may be working in interior places, you may not be knowing their language, but still, the way in which you can demonstrate your concerns will always help you to get them involved in your work, and that will be much more productive. Because our experience of interacting with these village school children helped us in identifying new clusters of archaeological material away from the area where we had, you know, initiated our work. The aim is to create new knowledge which makes room for everyone and breaks down barriers between past and present, science and belief, expert and layman. Provide information about the past and how it relates to the present. Emphasize an association, associating people, village with sites and the necessity to keep sites open at all times to all people. Never restrict the people who are curious about what we are doing. If you think that they are nuisance, that is the greatest damage you can do to yourselves. So this is the dictum, simple principles we have to, next one please. We have to keep in mind every time we launch a project of this kind. In-reach, next. Our main thrust while conducting public involvement is in-reach. Internal members are an important targeted public audience. We ourselves are public audience amongst ourselves. In-reach is passing on information to all archaeological team members. At the initial stages of 2008 outreach activity, the history of the region, publications, PhDs, site data, newspaper cuttings, and magazine articles and previous field seasons were made available to all the members of archaeological team, as well as those people who are curious in knowing why so many such, you know, printed material is there on that particular village settlement. And they can be made, explained why these are found only in professional journals, not amongst the public. That is where we have lost our responsibility. Health and safety booklets were also distributed to the members of the team. The initial two fieldwork days were taken as team tour days. All sites previously excavated, along with all new sites to be investigated, were visited. Next. The archaeological sites may not be impressive to the villagers, but it is the stories that come into being which are important. Though getting community support and understandings are neither easy nor straightforward, just going around the villages and sitting and listening and having plain talk works very well. Because some villages, they would obstruct entry of archaeologists at all. So initially you should not go with a big plan or, you know, tell them that this is what we want to do and all that. Just make friends with them and talk something, ask them what do they know about their village history and so on and so forth, and they come out. If not entire population, at least 10 people out of 1,000 population interact with you, that itself is a very, very productive, you know, move. The outreach program needs to constantly change and adapt to reflect the needs and resources of both the research and the community involved. We need to give something back to villagers, plain talk and not science jargon. That is very, very important, because they will not understand if we talk science to them. Our goals were create an environment for positive outcomes, not to antagonize with them and then get at loggerheads with them and their ideas and so on. Even if they have, you know, fantastic ideas about their village, accept them. And over a period of time, you can convince them that what they know about them and their village is different from what we are generating through our archaeological research. Genuinely and reflexively integrate the adjacent villages and archaeological team members into all aspects of understanding. It's not the only one village which is important to you. In the neighborhood, there is a network of villages, and even people passing by also have curiosity. And we have seen in our own experience, more than the villagers, villagers associated with the site itself, the passerby was even more curious, and sometimes we used to get weekend lunch or dinner invitations. The entire team of 20-30 people were invited by village leaders and so on. Outreach to individuals and groups at all sites and in the laboratory to include villages, schools, towns,
hotel staff, restaurants, all shops, jeep drivers, police, sarpanch, people in passing, people who visit our lab, all are important for us. We cannot isolate, we cannot identify this man is not useful, will not be useful, that man will not be useful. No such discrimination is allowed. Enriched professional archaeological staff to reinforce or implement public outreach concepts and provide updates on sites. It's not, you know, there is a separate team which comes into the enrich activity, and then next day it goes back with the new information to the villages. That is the most important event that takes place during the course of your outreach activity. Next one. So working to accomplish our goals. So we have to have villagers talk to villagers about what we are doing. So we should leave the material with some of these who have interacted with this. They have to go back and talk to their people to happen, but with correct information. But there are different families, castes within the village and literary rates, so information varies. So there is also a segregation in the village. There is a division in the community and so on. What we have to make sure is such things are not obvious to these people when we interact with them, to carry information about the history and prehistory of that area. Try to inform temples, schools, sarpanch, store kios, etc. They should also know what we are doing here. Otherwise, there are some people who will come, and you know, when we go back in the evening, they'll come and destroy our trenches. They can ransack our, you know, planned, you know, layout and so on and so forth. So we have to make sure that it is guarded properly. So people in the village are responsible for protecting the excavated areas. Given village third world life, our work is difficult to understand and have various meanings. In an attempt to actively and creatively and genuinely involve the local villages and everyone else, we came into contact with, during this archaeology and historic preservation project, a multi-pronged and constantly changing and flexible grassroots public involvement program was planned prior to archaeological field investigations. That was a prerequisite here. Then only they will come forward, otherwise they will demand a lot of things from us, which is beyond our abilities, scope. Our goal was to involve as many individuals and groups as possible as stakeholders in the decision-making process as it relates to their communities, cultural heritage, and natural history. The intent being to create an overarching series of comfortable relationships which build trust, friendship, and exceeds project goals. Next one. We had to prepare outreach and inreach materials for distribution. So we had to have multicolored brochures. And if we know that this is a bilingual area or a trilingual area, make sure that your brochure has information in all the languages in which the people in the village speak. Because it is not written in one language, it is antagonizing with the people who speak another language. So we made sure that our brochures, small booklets, even though it would cost us quite a bit, but it became very, very effective and useful for us. And such material were very, very useful in winning over the people's participation in our project. Solicit outreach and inreach ideas from everyone. It's not one person who decides what should be the layout, what should be the content, and so on. It is everybody. See, it's a collective effort, and prepare a brochure in such a way that all ideas of individual members of the team, as well as some of the local people, bring them together into this particular broker and make them available and distribute them like pamphlets, you know, instead of like we every day newspaper, when we open, we get number of pamphlets falling off. So likewise, we made effort to, you know, engage ourselves in distributing these brochures and pamphlets each and every household. Repeatedly knock the doors of the authorities concerned. The district administration is the immediate responsibility. And if they respond, you are the most luckiest person on earth. And of course, the district level authorities will help us in contacting people higher up who are directly concerned with the, you know, archaeological departments and so on. But sometimes we hardly get support from the state organizations or national level organizations. Just about 10 days ago, the ash mound at Kudithini was being consumed by the ongoing highway project. It is in the midst of the highway. And they had planned to destroy the entire, that is the largest Neolithic ash mound anywhere in South India. And we came to know that it is being destroyed for highway construction. We have to rush to the site, catch hold of local police, catch hold of deputy commissioner, catch hold of IGP of the range and so on. All of them were brought to the site. We explained them, and we had excavated 10 years ago. This is the material we have shown. And then they were convinced. Then immediately they requested the highway department to stop working for a couple of days, and then we worked out details and made sure that the highway was diverted. Instead of breaking open the ash mound, the highway was diverted, and this became a median of the highway. And that is the promise we got. And the police department even helped us to make sure that until the highway construction is completed in that area, there will be regular patrol by the police. This is the kind of, you have to have patience, and you have to make sure that you have time to do this. And that itself is a greater contribution than going about excavating and publishing professional articles and so on. So emphasize the need for interactive sessions between them and the outreach professionals. So an excavator himself may not be very articulate, but a professional outreach archaeologist will be very, very effective in communicating. And our village, Vijay village visits have got to be as frequent as possible. As we say, it is not the excavators themselves who have to go into the villages, but there is a separate team which is engaged in visiting. So continuous visits to village provide archaeological, discussions will be very, very useful. Outreach, outreach and inreach to everyone who come in contact with. We cannot ignore anybody who comes in. Genuinely and reflectively integrate the adjacent villages. That's equally important. This was beneficial because the neighboring village, some of the people came with some potsherds and pieces of stones, and they knew it is a man-made piece of stone and this is a pottery which is not modern. And that is how it helped us, extend our survey to the next village and the adjacent village and so on. So we should not think that the people who are very close to the archaeological site are important, but the people who are in the neighborhood are equally important. Outreach to individuals and groups at all sites and at lab. We have a lab in the field, and that is important for us because that is where we bring home our collections and then analyze them. So there is a separate team working in the laboratory who tell us, who come out with previous days, results of work on previous days collection and so on. And if these people who have interest in what we are doing, if they are also engaged, if they are also involved in interacting with us late in the evenings, that is also equally beneficial. Get to know your publics and try to understand them, their perspectives. Be careful not to present too much information. That is also dangerous. Keep it simple and fun. Have everyone share their experience so that they are genuinely involved. So developing collaborative approaches is important because your villagers are also part of the archaeological team. They are not just working with you as laborers. They are also now becoming archaeologists in their own right. So they have got to be involved in what we are finding during the course of our excavation at a particular site during the day. Bring into various archaeological activities from the field to the dissemination of results of persons outside to the trained professional archaeologists. Multivocality, multiple perspectives and meanings make for a more robust series of interpretations. Do not truly know and understand the past. It's difficult. Approach it with the way all individuals and groups, different people have, particularly common men, has a different approach to understanding his past. So we have to appreciate that particular thing. It's wide open to everyone's experiences and interpretations and meanings. Priority is dissemination of information is critical, frequent and often, as frequent as possible. Give back simple, plain, vernacular stories and pictures to everyone. Treat village interpretations as equal to archaeological ones. This is our dictum. And we then can equally learn from one another and build these alternative perspectives into our own understandings of the past and present. Explain how can the work we do benefit the villages, and how can the work the villages do benefit us. These are some of the things which are very critical to going about doing public outreach archaeology. At each site, along with regional perspective, an overview was presented of the history of excavations along with the site formation processes, known chronologies, and artifact assemblages. This is from the perspective of what we archaeologists have generated during the course of our work. during the initial week, dozens of pictures from earlier field seasons and other sites, and the crew, the villagers, the landscapes, and the newspaper articles from Sanganakallu site at Bellary, and the Delaware, the Department of Transportation outreach folders were distributed amongst ourselves, archaeologists, as well as some of the people who have volunteered to be, willing to understand what we are doing. Every third night, staff meetings were held, each site was updated, lab analysis provided, and everyone got to talk. That is important. Continual on-site real-time updates, students and professionals get to learn and sharpen and update archaeological skills and research in the lab and the field. So all this added to a new dimension. Next one. There's one more. Oh, this is one of the examples of, I will not be going into details of so many other programs we had. This is one interaction with school children along with the teachers and so on, where we replicated stone artifacts of the lower Paleolithic period. And then this very, very keenly, these children were observing the way in which stone acts were made by these particular archaeological lithic experts. And the next benefit was, in the next couple of days, many of these children came out with their own findings from other places, away from the area where we were excavating. That is the advantage of involving the school children and so on. And to get them to be part and parcel, the best thing, that the most important trick that we had to employ, was buy beautiful gifts, exotic objects, and give them in terms of presents to these children, and those, they are so happy to come and help you as well. Next. This is one of the posters we put up on the outreach activity we carried out at the Billasargam cave, Kottala village, and that's the various stages where people were involved in understanding what we are doing, and they took us to many more such caves in the area, which were not known to us, known to previous archaeologists working in this region. Hundreds of such caves. Of course, this is the largest cave is at Billasargam, but in the neighborhood, more than 100 such caves, small and large, not as large as Billasargam, were brought to light. And this is the advantage of getting to know these people as closely as possible. Next one. So this all added a new dimension. Our experience in southern India has convinced us, outreach program, when extended to prehistoric landscapes, its productivity is beyond expectations, leads to discovery of invisible sites, makes the natives around the sites aware of new variety of heritage, and makes them feel proud of the remote antiquity of their settlement. The study is reinforcement of the villagers' historic occupation, reinforcing their culture and history and ties to their land. Next one. So the advantages that we had to preserve the site of Sanganakallu, 1,000 acres, 5 large granitic hills. We were able to convince the district authorities, and over a period of time, we were able to approach the ministers. The tourism minister was involved in helping us. And then they sanctioned nearly 5 crores to make sure that archaeological survey is not protecting the site, State Department of Archaeology is not protecting the site. We ourselves, with the help of tourism minister and deputy commissioner of the district of Bellary, we generated funds and began to build a fence all around 1,000 acres of the site. This is the largest hill, which is also known as Peacock Hill, where we have the, on the plateau, we have the stone axe manufacturing site. This is the gateway being built. We are also public facility. This process under construction. Next one. These are the pillars of the gateway. The tourism minister has fancy for Vijayanagara architecture, so the gateway is designed in accordance with the, the monuments in the Hampi area, which are not very far from here, about 40 kilometers from this site. Next one. And then we, close to the hill at the site, we have these buildings where we have an interpretation center, we have a site museum, and a canteen, and so on. They are all under construction. Unfortunately, the person involved was charged of embezzlement and so on. For some time, the work has come to a standstill. Now the government has sanctioned 40 lakhs for further completion of this project. And next one. So we have this fence going on, barbed wire, all around the hill. And then we have some of the pavilions for viewers. Next one. This is a pavilion built at a viewpoint. In fact, this is a work spot on the site itself. But then the advantage was the viewpoint, so they built this kind of pavilions at various points along the hill. Next. And they also, in addition, they gave me a building, two-storied building, to establish the museum. And then they permitted me to bring in all antiquities that I have collected during the course of my 2 decades archaeological surveys in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. And this building, we are developing a museum. Next one. And in front of that, now archaeological survey is giving us on loan series of sculptures dating from the earliest to the most recent. Nearly 100 sculptures are being loaned to this museum. So in front, we will have a circular oval area with all these pavilions housing the sculptures ranging in time from earliest to the most recent, up to pre-colonial period, with information kiosks and so on. So it's an open-air museum here. And inside, yeah, next one. We have built the model of the Sanganakallu village. This is the largest hill. And then we have 4 more hills. The site was excavated in the 1940s by B. Subbarao, in the 1960s, Professor Rajguru and Dr. Mujumdar, and even Deccan College Professor Sankalia, Professor Davlikar and all. They have been going there from time to time, and they carried a series of investigations. And more recently, our team from Karnataka University, in collaboration with scholars from outside, we carried out this. This is a sunken area inside the museum building. We have this entire model of the Sanganakallu site, and we have label and all that is going on. Next one. Another view of the large hill. We have this dolerite dike cutting through this hill, and that was the major source of raw material for making stone axes. Next. So inside lower ground floor, we have this floor dedicated to displaying stages of human evolution. And then we have gifts from Cambridge University, the casts of human ancestors from different stages, from 7 million years ago to 200,000 years ago. We have these plaster casts. We have these stands. We'll carry information about each of these specimens. And then the walls have these dioramas with display of information, as well as antiquities which have been collected during the course of excavation at Sanganakallu, Jalapuram, and elsewhere. Next. This is a close-up of one of the more casts of the human ancestor. Next. And then they have also provided money for buying this kind of containers, wherein we are systematically placing all the antiquities, documenting them, and gradually we will be also doing digital imaging of each and every artifact. This is a long-term project, and once that is done, the whole all material will be available online for anybody to undertake research. And they don't have to come all the way to this particular museum, but they are available, they will be available online. Next. So public outreach projects have been rarely undertaken in developing countries, and this has rarely been undertaken in any formal way in India. There are a few exceptions to this. The examples include Dr. Padaya's public museum in the small town of Munsugi in Karnataka, Shanti Papu's Sharma Center for Heritage Education in Chennai, and most recently, our center at Sanganakallu and the Bellary Museum. As part of the large-scale multi-year archaeological project undertaken as part of the Kurnool District Prehistory Project, public outreach was intensified as a significant and valuable component of the project. Next. A stitch in time saves 9. So if we can make some effort in whatever way we can to save our heritage, this will always benefit the future of archaeology as well as future generations of archaeology. Thank you. We'll be happy to interact. Somebody there. Sinan.
In my village where I was born, there are 4 stones erect and slabs over the top of those 4 stone pillars. It is on the top of a small flat hill. not a very stiff hill. So what it may be or what it can be?
Normally a megalithic structure associated with burial practice.
What might be the time?
2000 years earlier than today.
Achha.
At least 3000 years ago.
Theek.
1000 BC time onwards but, we have these structures.
Around that stone pillar or the canopy, there is nothing else.
We have to look very carefully in the neighborhood.
Ah, yeah. Theek.
That is what we call invisible.
Oh, should I take some archaeologist to that place or it being a soul sign need not be?
Where is it?
It's about 60 kilometers from Ahmednagar district.
Megalithic structures, right? Oh, Iron Age, we call them Iron Age monuments. Somebody asked.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kolesetter, for your very informative and important lecture and presentation. I am quite impressed to see the efforts you and your colleagues have made to explore the heritage with public outreach. I would like to know if there are any other centers in India where this kind of approach is involved in investigation.
Unfortunately, we do not have a policy, what is called cultural resource management policy. Unless the senior generation here makes an effort and submits a memorandum to the government of India, this will never be. It's not a policy in any of the third world countries, unfortunately. So cultural resource management, before any developmental project is approved and then action begins, these CRM people go there, systematically survey, and if they find anything, they will map it, document thoroughly, and then remove the material to the museum and allow the project to go ahead. This is not the case. This is not mandatory in India as yet. So it is the willingness of the archaeologists themselves who are interested in doing. So most of us are eager to publish our articles in high impact factor journals and be happy with the, you know, what you call citation index and H index and so on.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is where we lost our heritage.
Yeah, so
I tell my colleagues and friends, if in our lifetime we can adopt one village, one settlement, one site,
mm-hmm.
to contribute to its preservation, depending upon its importance, we will be doing great service.
What is your experience about the cooperation from the public? Cooperation from the public.
See, the immediate response is negative.
Yeah.
Immediate response is negative, but you have to pursue with them. That's why there are techniques, in outreach archaeology. That helps.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, very good. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question. It is not exactly related to what you have said.
Huh.
Okay. The question is, you have mentioned in one of your slides that our human species, that Homo sapiens,
huh.
they migrated from Africa and through the path they came, through some path they came to India. But we also know that the earlier human species called Homo Neanderthalis, they migrated from Africa to Europe and to Europe.
No, it's not earlier. Neanderthals did not migrate from Africa. They are restricted to Europe and Southwest Asia. The ancestor of Homo Neanderthalensis was Rudolphensis, who migrated from Africa to Europe.
They evolved during the the transition.
Yeah. But they did not go back to Africa. The Homo erectus came out of Africa, that is the early Pleistocene event. And Homo sapiens around 200,000 years ago, they evolved in Africa, and over the next 100,000 years, they went across the globe, and now they are all over.
So in India, the only human species or evidence of only human species that is available is only Homo sapiens, or do we have any?
There is one evidence from site called Hathnora in central India, Narmada River. It is suspected to be pre-Homo sapiens. It's called archaic Homo sapiens or advanced Homo erectus. But there's a debate among paleoanthropologists, and some people say it is indeterminate. There are three schools of thought. But there is one fossil human remains coming from the site of Hathnora. In addition, they have found few more fossilized bones. But they are dating back to at least 250,000 years. So it is pre-Sapien in the context of the date.
Okay.
But otherwise, we are in fact went to these caves in search of human remains only. But okay. we found something else, and then our work shifted, our focus shifted to another area, another problem, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
पण मला सांगायचं आहे असं की आपल्या अभ्यास क्षेत्राची जोडणी सतत वर्तमान वास्तवाशी आणि विशेषतः माणसांशी विलेजर्सशी तुम्ही जे म्हणालात त्यांच्याशी करणं हे फार कमी वेळा स्कॉलर्सकडून घडतं. आत्ता आर्किओलॉजिकल साईटच्या निमित्ताने ते खूप मोठ्या प्रमाणावर तुम्हाला करावं लागलेलं आहे आणि त्याची सक्सेस स्टोरी बनवणं हे तुमचं यश आहे. कारण एरवी आपण असं पाहतो की साध्या साध्या बघायला गेलेल्या काय आर्किओलॉजीनी प्रिझर्व केलेल्या वास्तू किंवा गुहा किंवा त्या प्रकारच्या ज्या स्थळं आहेत त्याची सुद्धा म्हणजे टुरिस्ट म्हणून पर्यटक म्हणून गेल्यानंतर सुद्धा बूज राखली जात नाही किंवा त्या सहजपणाने खराब केल्या जातात असं अशी एकूण दृष्टी असताना आणि कुठल्याच प्रकारची जाणीव जागृती आपल्याकडे या प्रकारे केली जात नसताना तुमचं हे यश आहे हे विशेष आहे. ते केवळ विलेजर्सच्या बाबतीतलं नाही आहे. म्हणजे आता आमची एक मैत्रीण ही कोकणामध्ये खाणींच्या विरोधामध्ये काम करायला सुरुवात केली तिने एन जी ओमधून. पण तिने असं म्हटलं की हे आम्ही जाऊन बाहेरून एखाद्या गोष्टीला विरोध करणं हे नाही होणार. त्या गावातल्या लोकांना वाटलं पाहिजे की आमच्या भोवतीचा निसर्ग राखला पाहिजे आमच्या भोवतीचे टेकड्या राखल्या पाहिजेत आणि म्हणून गावकऱ्यांनी उठलं पाहिजे यासाठी प्रयत्न करणं. त्याच प्रकारची एक जोडणी मी इथे करते आणि मग असं वाटतं की एका बाजूला लोकसहभाग या बाबतीतला महत्वाचा आहे हे जाणलं पण त्याच्या जोडीलाही सक्सेस स्टोरी घडण्यासाठी तुम्हाला शासनाची आणि तशा प्रकारच्या सगळ्या ज्या आता सिस्टीममधल्या इतर संस्था आहेत त्यांची चांगली मदत झाली सर. आणि ते सगळीकडे भारतभरात घडलं आहे असं दिसत नाही. मला माहिती नाही की याच्यामध्ये तुम्हाला त्यासाठी किती झगडावं लागलं मला माहिती नाही. आणि तेही मला विचारावं असं वाटतं की जसं तुम्ही ह्या लोकसहभागाची हळूहळू हळू एक एक पायरी आणि सुरुवातीचा त्यांचा जो विरोध आहे किंवा त्यांचा इग्नरन्स आहे तो दूर करत करत तुम्ही तिथपर्यंत पोहोचलात. पण ही जे इतर सिस्टीमची अंग आहेत त्यांच्या बाबतीतला तुमचा अनुभव प्रथमपासून अनुकूल होता.
नॉट एक्झॅक्टली इट इज नाऊ एसेन्शियल टू इन्क्लूड पब्लिक आउटरीच आर्किओलॉजी एज पार्ट अँड पार्सल ऑफ आर्किओलॉजी कोर्सेस. देन वील हॅव सेपरेट रिसोर्स पर्सन्स available for spreading awareness amongst people of all sections in a village, town, even in cities also. This awareness is very important. Our concern is the landscapes which have a lot of heritage preserved in them, not this kind of monuments and so on, which are well protected, easily visible, people are attracted and so on. And even these hero stones, inscriptions and all, when they are left for neglected actually. But unless people go into those villages, interact with the people and find out what is there known to them, especially senior citizens, they are very, very helpful in providing information about their village and what is there in terms of remains and so on. This is possible, but we have to have a lot of patience as archaeologists. So we are interested in collecting material, produce an article, and then come back and submit our report, make a proper submission of accounts and so on. But here this is a major endeavor in itself. Yeah.
Hello sir, rakhigadi sarki site kashi preserve karnar apan lokancha sahabhag yon
site like Mohenjo-daro is also not well preserved. And only just about 2 weeks ago there was a major seminar involving archaeologists from 40 countries discussing about how to preserve Mohenjo-daro. This is neglect. It is a world heritage site, but the local people are not involved in it. I have been there few years ago, but I saw, and in fact I made a Facebook statement that we are in tears when we visited the site. But then local people were least involved. They were only selling in, you know, imitations of antiquities found at Mohenjo-daro, selling to tourists. Their museum also is in a very bad state. So unless you educate them and make them aware that they own this site, not anybody else coming from outside. Mohenjo-daro belongs to the people who live in the neighborhood of Mohenjo-daro. And then only we'll contribute to its preservation.
Sir, mi rakhi gadi cha utkhananat bhag ghetlela hota. तर लोकांचा सहभाग होता त्याच्यामध्ये, पण जेव्हा साईट बंद व्हायची म्हणजे आम्ही परत जायचो कॅम्पला.
व्हॉट इफ इट इज कव्हर्ड बाय मॉडर्न टाउन?
सर नाही, ज्यावेळेस बोटॅनिकल सेक्शन घेतला होता लास्ट इयर एक्सकॅव्हेशन, त्यावेळेस तिथनं काही गोष्टींची चोरी झालेली होती, म्हणजे काही पॉट्स वगैरे सगळे तिथनं ट्रेंचमधनंच काढून नेलेले होते. मग अशा वेळेला लोकांचा सहभाग घेतला तर ती साईट राहील का?
बट दे नीड फंडिंग फॉर प्रिझर्वेशन, दॅट इज इक्वली इम्पॉर्टंट. अँड द एक्सकॅव्हेटर्स आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर जनरेटिंग फंड्स. Give the authority, give the permit, you know, ASI is involved in its excavation. Earlier, many senior scholars were excavating that site. None of them thought of, you know, because this is the largest site in India, as far as we know. But if it is left like that, excavated and trenches are open and then people come out, it will certainly get ruined. So we are responsible. If anything, any damage takes place to the site, we are responsible. Who excavated the site?
As far as this archaeologist subject is concerned in India,
the discipline has a future, but job opportunities are to be generated. And you know, you see in any level, education level, the institutions are also suffering shortage of resources, shortage of teaching faculty, this and that. So restrictions are there. So they think that, you know, archaeology is about past and why should we worry about it? And so development is important and generating jobs is important, right? Thank you.
अण्णांनी भारतीय संस्कृतीचा अनेक अंगांनी अभ्यास केला हे आपल्याला सगळ्यांना माहिती आहे, पण अण्णांनी फक्त परंपरेतल्या जुन्या गोष्टींचे अर्थ उलगडून सांगितले असं नाही आहे. अण्णा कायमच भूतकाळाला वर्तमानाच्या उजेडात बघत आले. आणि मला आज आनंद झाला की डॉक्टर कोरीसेटरांनी आपल्याला जी यशोगाथा सांगितली त्यामध्येही आपल्या परंपरेचा आजच्या स्थितीमध्ये काय महत्त्व आहे आणि स्थानिक रहिवाशांसाठी त्याचं काय महत्त्व आहे हे सांगणारीच ही यशोगाथा आहे. त्यामुळे केंद्राचा हा पहिला अकॅडमिक प्रोग्रॅम खऱ्या अर्थाने आनंद देणारा आमच्यासाठी ठरला आहे. सगळ्या श्रोत्यांनाही तसंच वाटलं असेल याची मला खात्री आहे. हा आनंद व्यक्त करते आणि भांडारकरच्या श्रीनंद बापटांकडे माईक सोडतो.
Friends, just like our friends were discussing about some other sites, I have with my own eyes seen the largest archaeological site of Maharashtra, Prakashe, being destroyed with JCB machines. And now I think you will find nothing at Prakashe because everything has been completely taken down with JCB machines. I have also seen the site of Zorwe being destroyed by habitation in the similar fashion. 20 years ago, the site of Zorwe was definitely in a good shape, but today if you go there, it has been completely, it has been completely buried under habitation, I will say. It is rather a different terminology than archaeological terminology. But this approach, what Dr. Kurisetter was describing about, we were successful in doing one such operation about one manuscript collection in Nasik. And that manuscript collection was facing a civil trial of the descendants of that particular scholar. And there was a third generation of descendants who is now on the scene actually. And that collection of manuscripts was under lock from 1973, and with efforts and the credit goes to our colleague there, Dr. Anita Joshi, who could effectively take it out from the court's seal and has documented that collection. And we have a very beautiful collection of 2,200 manuscripts that has now come to light. And otherwise it would have been lost to termites and to rats. But that effort has been done to a very small, in a very small scale by this institute. What I find from Dr. Kurisetter's speech, the most part of it is his fervency for the subject, talmud. And it was the best example of fervency for the subject that I have seen in this particular hall that I should mention. I should thank you, him, on the behalf of all of us for this particular lecture, and certainly I assure him that if he needs some help in his work from this institute, we have so many friends who are studying Indology and archaeology. We shall be more than happy to help him in his projects, and if he suggests some projects for us, we'll certainly consider to undertake them. I also thank the other organizers, the R.C. Dere Center for Cultural Studies, and also the media for giving due publicity to this particular function, and all of you without whom the function would not have come into existence. Thank you.